You are doing an amazing thing. You are changing the world one person at a time because you're choosing to do this irrational thing called homeschooling. And I believe that if you understood how much God loved you, that He has access to your children's brains and consciences, that He will strongly support those whose heart is completely His, that you would have a sense of how important what you're doing is, how great you are because you have learned to love God and you want to pass that love on to that generation. So how's everybody doing this afternoon? Has anybody had their cups filled a little bit, I hope? Yes. Okay, I have to do this. How many people have never heard me before? Oh, you're kidding. You're in the best session for the whole conference. No. And I'm not kidding. No. Okay, so I have to go through this again. My name is Sally Clarkson. My husband and I started Whole Heart Ministries after we had been in missions and in ministry and on church staffs and on staff with Campus Crusade for Christ. We came back to America and said, oh my goodness, this country is falling apart. The youth in this country have no morals, no foundation. The marriages are falling apart. What are we going to do? So after having spent many years discipling people, leaders, refugees, all sorts of people, executives, we started Whole Heart Ministries about 15 years ago, and started writing our own materials. We started our own publishing house. We're so blessed. We just keep having one more quiet time, and it gives us something to write about. We have homeschooled our children all the way through. Our children are 25, 22, 20, and 14. We had three children, three miscarriages, and another child who now has five parents. I was saying to my husband last week, if I've already done this teenage thing three times, do I have to do it four times? And he said, yes. But anyway, very long story short, I'm trying to cover things. The Mom Heart Conference. How many women in here have been to our Mom Heart Conferences, or our Mom Conferences? And do you like them? Yeah. Woo, Stacey. And what we said in the last hour, I had all these men coming up to me saying, thank you so much that you have these conferences every year. When I was 44 years old and I would get to the end of my day and I would say to my husband, this is the hardest thing I've ever done. And he would say, what do you want? And I said, a conference just for moms in a hotel with clean sheets and chocolate and a nice lunch in civility. And I just had the best lunch with these friends. And when godly women show up to share their hearts with each other, there's a palpable life that happens. And so we're having our Dallas conference, as we always do. It's February 26th and 27th. Start saving for it now. We have great speakers. We have really focused a lot of energy into this time. And the other thing is we are building a ministry. I'll be speaking about it at 4:30 this afternoon. After all these years of discipleship and training and working with people all over the world, our books are in six languages, we see so strongly that if parents have biblical friendships and accountability in small groups, if they're going through the Word, if they're praying together, they will last resiliently and they will accomplish God's will. If they're alone, they become a target and they become discouraged, and they lose their ideals. And so we're starting a small groups ministry all over the world. I just returned from a six-city tour of China. Thousands of people. It was incredible. They need to be with godly people to encourage them, and so do you. So we are having our first Mom Heart training. This is for people who want to be leaders, who want to start a group in your church, a homeschool group, whatever. You want to be trained how to lead, how to inspire, how to encourage other women. We're trying to really establish a strong support system all over the world. We'll have blogs and websites and tapes and CDs. All of our books have Bible study questions in the back of them because we want you to be inspired to walk with God and to change the world in the power of the Holy Spirit because you have Christian and godly input. So come listen this afternoon. We'll talk about it. And my blog is itakejoy.com. People said, tell me what that is. It's so much fun. Thank you. It's you know, you're pouring your heart out, and it's nice to know there's at least one person out there in cyberspace. Does anybody here read my blog? Yay! Say yes, even if you don't, so I'll feel good. Okay, and I'm going to quickly go through. People have said, what are the difference in books? I'll be talking about this afternoon or tomorrow. I feel like a lot of women don't want to admit, maybe men don't want to admit, I don't even know what it means to walk with God, or how to have a quiet time, or how do you live by faith, or what do you do with these mysterious, difficult people? I'll be talking about that tomorrow. I'll be talking kind of a combination today between Seasons of a Mother's Heart and a couple of these books. Mission of Motherhood is the first book I got to speak on in the United States Congress, Book of the Year. When you get to this whole mothering issue, what does God have in mind? What are you supposed to accomplish? What is the vastness of your calling? If you don't know it, you won't build greatly. That's what mission is. Then ministry is you focus in. So how do you reach their hearts? What do you do to build spiritual maturity, discipleship? And then seasons, and I'll start out with seasons right now because I have a story from seasons. But we're talking about enduring to the end of the day. How do you last resiliently? How do you stay focused? How do you stay faithful? And I really think that there are so many people who drop out of anything, marriage, ideals, homeschooling, an idealistic job, ministry. Why? Because we are in a spiritual battle. And many times we haven't been prepared what it means to be a warrior, what it means to last. And secondly, we don't have a lot of people in culture, even sometimes in our churches, who are telling us how to endure, how to make it through all the seasons. So I want to pray for us, and then I'm going to start out with a story. This is a true story. Dear Heavenly Father, I am so, so humbled and grateful that I have this opportunity to have a quiet time and then to share what I've learned from you with these wonderful, wonderful families. And Lord, I thank you for the ways you've blessed my children and you blessed our family and that you've given us a godly heritage. And you've been so patient, Lord, and so long-suffering with us. And I pray that in this hour, everyone here will really be filled with the Spirit in the sense that they'll hear conviction or encouragement or hope or whatever it is that they need to hear, Lord. Help them to know that it is their walk with you that will determine how they please you and how they do with their children, because you are the one who meets us, who informs us, who undergirds us, and who works in the lives of our children. Bless us today, we pray. Keep us from the evil one and cause us to walk in your presence every moment. In Jesus' name, amen. I was at a conference like this, and for any of you who are speakers or teachers, you know that, and this is for pastors, after you know you have the Monday morning blues or maybe the Sunday afternoon blues, whenever I speak, I always have a sense of, oh, I should have said this. Oh, that was dumb. Oh, you know, whatever it is, you kind of, if you're introverted at all, you have that time where you're going through what you were just talking about and hoping it mattered and promising you'll do better next time. And so I was at a conference kind of going through my little thing, and this lady came up to me, and she had on, she is perfect. You know, she had a svelte body, and she was dressed for success, and she had on a black silk suit, and she had on the perfect heels, and her hair was wedged, and she just kind of looked like, you know, she was out of some impossible situation. I always try to look really adult when I speak, but it's not necessarily how I am at home, obviously. But this lady was kind of threatening to me, but she came up to me and she said, excuse me, Mrs. Clarkson, could I have a few minutes of your time? And so I said, well, sure. And so she took me to the back corner of a little cafe so nobody would hear us. And she started pouring out this story to me. And she said, you know, basically, she had come from a family who was somewhat poor when she was growing up, but her parents paid a lot of attention to her. And she said, you know, I've decided that I would never be poor because I don't want my children to have that humiliation. So I became an executive, and I was accomplishing all this stuff. And anyway, she climbed up the ladder. She had the car she wanted, the house she wanted. She was professional. People respected her. And she said, then I found this handsome man. And she said, I thought, all that's missing in my life is getting married to this man. And he was really, at the time, very handsome, and he wooed me. And I thought, this is what I need to be fulfilled in my life. So she got married. And she said, and then I thought, well, you know what will complete our marriage is if we can have children. And she said, and then I had this child. And she said, and it was a failure to thrive child. And so I had to spend 10 months helping this little baby live. And she said, and I pretty much lost my identity. And she said, basically, because of all the bills and because of all the difficulties, we had to sell my beautiful home. And we had to move into a home that was not, she said, I'm embarrassed to even tell people where I live. Because I don't like to have people over unless I can show them a really good time. And she said, and I honestly resent what these children have taken away from me. And she said, and now I don't even love my husband anymore. He just has become unappealing. And so she said, what am I supposed to do? Because as I see it, God has let me down. And as I was sitting there listening to her, I thought, you know, it would be really easy for me to criticize her. But I thought, that's me. That's me in another situation. Maybe my circumstances weren't the same. But I realized that there are times when I come to God. And I, you know, it's kind of like the first little part of your life. Like when you get married, you're never going to have an argument. What is wrong with all these other people who get divorced? And when you hold your child in your arms and you think, oh, this president of the United States, you know, this child, or else you think, why won't it sleep? But whatever it is, you know, then there comes a point in homeschooling, as in marriage, as in children, when you have to say, this is it? I mean, do I have to give up? What if my husband never changes? I have to live with him for the next 30,000 years? And then you get these children, and they're not what you thought about. And then you homeschool them, and they aren't perfect. And then you read every manual in the world, and you spend thousands of dollars on curriculum. And it didn't turn out a perfect child with perfect SAT scores. And then some of you are just 40, and you're exhausted. And you're sick of this. You still believe in it, but you don't want to do it anymore. How do we endure till the end of the day? I just finished a new book that'll come out in January called Dancing with My Father. And it's really pursuing joy in a fallen world, in a disappointing world. Because I had been on a mission trip, and here I was with these godly people who had been in missions for years and years. And I would be walking along, you always walk when you're in these European mission things, and I'd be walking along, the husband would say, you know, I'm kind of disappointed in my wife. We've been here 15 years, and she's never learned the language, and it's limited our mission. And then I would go along with the wife, and she would say, you know, my husband doesn't support me. I've had to homeschool these kids, or whatever it was. And then I went with some staff that I had discipled many years before, and I realized that there is a part in life when, you know, you start, have you ever seen those pictures of those old pioneer women? You know, they made it. And, you know, but barely. And you look at it, and I was sitting in this little park in Poland, because that's where I first started out as a missionary many years ago. And I was remembering, oh yeah, when I was here and it was communist, I believed that God could do miracles. I even believed that he was good. And subtly, over the years, I had gotten to the point where I was beginning to think, Lord, I have served you. I have loved you. I have honored you. This is the way you treat people you like? And not really, but do you know what I mean? And I thought, here the missionaries were in the same point. And so that's why I wrote this book. I thought, Lord, help me to understand biblical joy. Because if it says joy is the fruit of the Spirit, then I should be able to experience joy, period. And so I was talking with my daughter, Sarah, and a lot of you have heard me talk about her this weekend. And Sarah and I were talking a few weeks ago, and she's the one who wrote the great blog that you need to go to itinerantidealist.com. It will so encourage you. It'll blow you away that a homeschool child can have that kind of spirituality at this age. And how did she get it? We loved her, we taught her about the Lord, but she's had a hard life. That's how she became spiritual. She writes about learning how to choose courage, choose strength, and walk in the mountaintops. But she said, you know, Mom, I think one of the problems in the homeschooling movement and in life in general is that we don't get that this is the broken place. We think if we can envision ideals, that we should be able to have that ideal from God. That he's somehow obligated to do our will. And what I realized is that for many years, I would go to God and I would say, God, this is my will. Bless this. Do it now. Do it when I want to. And I pray it in the name of Jesus with all of my heart. And so you need to do it because I told you so. And then he wouldn't do it. Or he didn't do it my way. And as I was writing this book, I realized that sometimes we come into this whole paradigm in the world. We think it's supposed to be here. And what I've realized is that Jesus said, I discipline you that you may share in my holiness. You see, while we're standing back being parents of our children, God is standing back being our parent. And he says, you know what? He says, in this world, you have tribulation. But take courage. What are you supposed to do when you're overwhelmed and depressed? Take courage. Courage means I will determine that I will make this. You see, he's suiting us. He's trying to make us unselfish. He's trying to make us servants. He's trying to make us excellent because we were created to do excellent things. And he's preparing us for a kingdom where everything will be perfect. Well, he will reign. But even Jesus himself didn't get what he wanted in this world. He said, Father, if it's your will, take this cup from me. But not my will, but yours be done. And as I look back over my life, I'm so glad I lived long enough because I really see that all these things I tried to take on myself or figure out. If I just keep thinking, I'll figure this one out. We think we can figure God out. We think we can figure our marriage out. We think we can figure our children out. It says God wants us to walk by faith. God knows what we need. God knows what our children need. So the first thing about enduring until the end of the day is you have to say, not my will, but yours be done. God, I am your servant. No matter what, I will plant this flag. No matter what you do to me, you are good. I'm going to believe that you're good. I don't understand it. I don't know what you're doing. As I look back, I realize that most of our problems have been what God has used to give us the capacity to minister to thousands of people. Because what would it be like if Clay and I had had a perfect life, a perfect marriage, perfect finances, perfect children, and perfect homeschooling? We would come out and say, very pridefully, you need to do this, you dumb people. And if you do it my way, it's God's way, and then you'll be okay. But if you don't, it won't. No. Why? Because how can we minister if we haven't struggled, if we haven't been humbled, if we haven't had to live by faith, if we haven't been depressed? Because that's where you live. How can a person ever become a general if he hasn't first gone through basic training? How can a person learn to lead people if he hasn't defeated the enemy in many battles? And that, anyway. And what I want you to know is it's God's will for you to be mature, for you to grow, so that you can have the ability to encourage others. He wants you to walk with him in your home when you don't understand what's happening, when it doesn't make sense, when the other spouse isn't loving, but you're still supposed to. Because guess who's watching you? Your children. How are they going to know what it looks to live by faith if they can't watch you and say, oh, but my mom and dad trusted God? Clay and I were going through a really hard time at one point, many points actually, but this particular point. Why? Because we weren't prepared for marriage. We were selfish. We were young. We were immature. We have different personalities. We're living in a fallen world, and we had sinful children. And none of them were normal. And we moved 17 times. We had in our house, we've had a fire, 3 floods, 7 car accidents. I mean, I sound like Paul, don't I? But anyway, you sound like Paul too. And at this particular day, I was kind of in bed. We were just awakened in the morning. It was about 5:30 in the morning. We were living in Nashville. And I was pretty mad at him. I thought, he doesn't meet my needs. He doesn't know how many things I'm doing for God. He doesn't appreciate that I'm taking care of all of the children's needs. Anyway, whatever it is, you know, how you feel that, you know, this imperfect person over here is not making me feel good about myself. And so I was just sitting there, and it happened to be the year that he had had two ruptured discs. We had been cheated by a Christian ministry out of $10,000. My mother had broken her hip, and I had had to go 10 times to her bedside to take care of her. One of our children had a potential brain tumor and had been in and out of the hospital, and I can tell you, we were both spent. But anyway, I was kind of willing bad things towards him. I wasn't saying it because I'm godly. You know? But I was willing over to him. I was going, pity party, make me feel good. And I thought, maybe he'll feel it. And then all of a sudden, it's as though the Holy Spirit put his finger on my heart, and the Holy Spirit said, you need to love him and give him grace. So I willed my hand. And I said, honey, I just want you to know I really love you. I'm committed to you, and I'm really praying for you. He turned over, and he said, oh, that is such a relief. He said, I was just sitting here thinking how disappointed you must be in me. He said, my back is in constant pain. I'm feeling so many financial pressures. I think I'm going to burst. I don't have one more ounce to give to the kids, but just knowing that you are committed to me means so much to me. What I didn't know, one of the kids was standing outside the door. Now, they know there's stress in our house. They know that Dad's not feeling well. They know that my mom has broken her hip. But they, by the grace of God, saw us walking with God. And guess what? When they're having difficulty in their marriage, they're going to say, oh, I remember. Mom and Dad have had troubles, but they have stuck it out. And what I finally realized, everybody's going to come to this point of disappointment. I thought if I did this, it would work perfectly. I thought if I, you know what? At some point, you have to say, what if my spouse never changes? Can I still be godly? Yes. All you have to do is walk with God and become a servant leader. You see, your faith isn't really of any value until you believe God in the darkness and decide to be spiritual anyway. Now, one of the main problems with this is none of us, very few of us, as a matter of fact, were trained to have godly character. We live in America. We have Walmart. We have Target. We have, you know, you deserve a cell phone, a TV, a computer, a car, your own house. You deserve insurance. You deserve for Obama to give you free insurance. It doesn't cost you. You deserve no tax. Well, no, I'm sorry. You can't get away with the taxes. Anyway, I just returned from China. You need to go to China. It helped me a lot. People were living in hovels. They had holes at the back of their place. We traveled. We were the only white, non-Chinese speaking people. It was really hard. You know, our wonderful person we traveled with, we were speaking, Mission of Motherhood is now in Chinese, and they would rent these halls and universities and state, it's just incredible, and thousands of people would show up. I wasn't allowed to say Jesus or God, but I figured out that I could pretty much give my talk without saying Bible or Jesus. I would say, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And if you don't build character into your children's lives, there will be no heritage. And he who walks with the wise. So I got to say everything that I always say, but I just didn't say Bible or Jesus. And as I was there, I was thinking, oh my goodness, these people, they took notes on everything. They stood in line for hours. They said, pray for me, pray for my marriages. Of course, we're not supposed to pray. We're talking to them, you know, saying, aren't you wonderful? God bless you. Isn't this what you were, because we had the secret police here. Anyway, I have no idea why I told you that story. That is a problem that you get older and your brain goes. But anyway, being there helped me to realize, as Americans, God never promised us. He never promised you that you could have everything you wanted. And I finally realized that, you know, in the same way that a two-year-old will have a tantrum, and they'll say, but I want that whole bag of potato chips. And if you're a wise parent, you know that if they have it, they'll get sick. So you don't give it to them. You take them in your arms. You do whatever you've decided to do in your discipline. And you say, no, you may not. You've got to learn to submit. Well, I realize that that's what God does to me. He is not threatened by my tantrums. When I think, where have you gone? He's still there. He said, even darkness is not dark to thee, to me. He said, I knew your days when as yet there was not one of them. In this world you have tribulation. The just shall live by faith. Take courage. Love your enemies. Stay faithful. Stay loyal. Now, I know that all of you wouldn't be at this conference unless you wanted to be a Christian who served and pleased God. Well, then you have to accept the mantle he's given you to wear. Because Satan would just love for you to capitulate or to give in. As a matter of fact, the most important time to stay faithful is in the time you most don't want to stay faithful. And what I want you to know is that this culture will give any of you any kind of permission to capitulate. You deserve a break. No one would put up with that man. You can't reach that child. You're too inadequate. Put them in school. Put them, whatever. Maybe in just a few years, they're going to leave, and then I won't have to deal with them anymore. Now, we've all thought that. Come on. Any of you who have these children who keep coming back home, no, I'm teasing. But the point isn't, what bad thoughts have you had? The point is, what do you do with the bad thoughts you've had? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. I don't know how I'm going to make it, Lord, but you know. So I'm going to believe in this situation, this is a holy place, and no matter what my husband does, my children does, I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to bow my knee and say, there is a God in the universe, and I will serve him until the day I die. Now, what are some of the difficulties, though, that you have to understand? There is a lot of junk in the homeschooling movement. And a lot of junk people are very sincere about. And they just want a formula. We talked in our conferences this year that the four F's, and one is, you can't live by formula. Why was Jesus so vague in Scripture? He wanted us to live by faith. There's only two commandments just about in Scripture. Honor your parents, obey your parents. And then Proverbs gives a lot of wisdom, but it doesn't say spank for 45 minutes with a paddle, use a PVC pipe. If it's a girl, do it the first time, the third time, the tenth time, the fifth time. No, it doesn't say that in Scripture. It says in Scripture, there's truth here. You have to walk by faith. Sometimes a child doesn't need to be disciplined. They need to be put to bed because you're the abusive parent. You've overstimulated them. Sometimes a little boy who has testosterone is going to do stupid things. He doesn't need to be disciplined for being a little boy. He needs you to understand him. Whatever it is, you need to walk by faith. We would like a formula. You also can't live by the flesh. If I just try hard enough, I'm going to get up at 5 from now. I'm going to get up at 4 from now. I'm going to buy a new day timer. This year, I'm going to finish every single lesson, no matter what. You know, I mean, you can kind of get along in your 20s and 30s. And then in your 40s, you just go, pew! And flesh doesn't work anymore. You know, it doesn't. And then your kids are having hormones, and you're having hormones. And you're going, why are you being so irrational? Flesh does not do it. You also can't live by fear. Keep these children from ever going into the outside world. Keep them from meeting their next door neighbors. Keep them from meeting mom and dad. Keep them, you know, oh my gosh, what if they get pregnant, drug addicted, raped? Oh my gosh, I'm so afraid. No. Jesus said, I do not pray that you take them out of the world, but you keep them from the evil one. He allowed Peter to fail so that Peter would be humble. Now, don't hear me wrong. I'm not saying you send your six-year-olds into the world. No. Your six-year-olds are unprotected. They don't have a brain yet. And even teenagers don't have a total brain yet. Do you understand that? There's this testosterone wash in boys. There's something that children have to question you because they're moving from childhood to adulthood. And they have to say, I know more than mom and dad. That's just teenagehood. And they may not like you sometimes. A lot of people don't like me. As a matter of fact, Clay stopped having people do evaluations when I spoke. Because he said, if 800 people like you and 5 people hate you, you say, I'm quitting, that's it, I'm not speaking anymore. You know, everybody hated me. Nobody liked what I said. I was so stupid. I wish I'd prepared more, but I have these kids and they don't ever let me have time to prepare. You can't live by fear. You can't live by performing for other people. You have to say, I don't know all the answers, but I have the Lord Jesus Christ. I have the Word of God. I have the Holy Spirit, and it says He is there to remind me. But what I can tell you is that you cannot have a spiritual life and spiritual authority if you're not having time with God. You cannot. That's why we're doing the mom heart groups. We want to help moms know how to walk with God, know how to study the Word. You need spiritual accountability. I'll tell you what happens to somebody who's alone. When you're alone in your home, you have no support from culture, no support from your church, you aren't getting enough rest. You have limitations. You know, Sarah said to me not too long ago, Mom, I think it would be a good idea if you could kind of monitor yourself before you blow. I don't know what she was talking about. We are in a very highly stressful life. If you have ideals, I've always told my children, if you stand up in front of people, already 20% of the people don't like you. You become a target. Who are you pleasing? You're having to please God. I've told this story a number of times, and it's in Seasons of a Mother's Heart. And people say, which book should I get? All of them. They are all profound. I wouldn't write them if I didn't have a passion about what I'm learning. It's in this book. And long story short, you know, I mean, I was probably still in that, I think I can do it if I try enough phase. And so we were living in Walnut Springs, where we were involved in this musical production of The Life of Christ 6 months out of the year, every Friday and Saturday night. Our kids were up until midnight. We had to do it because it's how we made enough money to live so that we could get Whole Heart Ministries going. So every Friday and Saturday night, we had been taking our kids. We stay up till 12. We're exhausting ourselves. We're homeschooling. We're starting our ministry. We're doing these books. And so we decided that because we were putting 5,000 miles a month in our car, because we lived way out in the country because it was free, we decided to move to Fort Worth, Texas. So we just moved in here November 1st. And I thought, oh, everybody's expecting to come to my house for Thanksgiving this year. So we invited our family, who almost never comes to see us. And so all the way through November, I'm putting, you know, pictures on the walls, and I'm trying to, you know, get things kind of straightened, but I keep moving boxes back to hide them to my bedroom because it was in the back of the house. And so we had the Thanksgiving, big turkey, great food, smile on our faces, you know, so they can like the homeschooling family. And, you know, there's always this performance thing going. And then as we get through Thanksgiving, my kids said, we have to have the Christmas open house that we always do. It's tradition. So I'm thinking, okay, we need friends. You know, we've gone to Clay's childhood church. There's a number of families there and that we'd known for some years. And so anyway, I'm killing myself. I made the cookies. I made the traditional chili con queso. I did all this stuff. And then I just kept pushing boxes back to our bedroom. Finally, our bedroom was kind of the only one that was piled high. We bought lots of stuff and too many books. And so we have this open house, light the candles, make it dark, give lots of goodies, and nobody will see anything. So we were walking through with some of my friends had come over, and they said, oh, it's so fun to be at your new house. It was a new old house, secondhand house, new to us. And I said, oh, thanks. You know, it's such a provision of God. It's so nice to be able to go to the grocery store in 5 minutes and this and that. And this one woman goes, what's that room with the door closed? And I, it's just our bedroom. And she said, oh, show us your bedroom. And I said, you know, I'm pondering in my mind, how secure am I? How much of my real self do I want to reveal? And so I thought, oh, these women know my life. They're just like me. So I said, well, you know, we've been so tired, and I've been trying to undo. We've got lots of boxes in there. And so I opened the door, They go in. They're all standing in my bedroom. And this one lady says, you know what a really godly woman told me? She said, if you really love your husband, the first room that you will organize is your bedroom. That speaks volumes to him. Who cares that I've been homeschooling for 10,000 years, that I get up in the middle of the night with my asthmatic child, that I have served meals, that I just served a great meal to my family, that I study the Bible? Who cares? All of a sudden I realize, oh my gosh, she's right. I have blown it. Why do I even try? No matter how hard I try, I still keep doing wrong things. I still keep blowing it. Oh, you know, and so I, for about 2 weeks, I was Eeyore. Let's have our devotionals. You know, and I just felt this weight, but I couldn't talk to Clay about it because I just couldn't take one more bit of condemnation. I was already feeling inadequate about myself. So finally, one night, you know, I know this because my mom said, never talk to a man when he walks in the door. And my mom was the one who taught me. She lit candles, put on bright red lipstick every night. And, you know, she'd kind of have us straighten up the main part of the house. This is off the subject. And I would say to my mom, Mom, why do you do that? And she said, because your father is working with beautiful secretaries who are there to meet his needs. So... And she said, and I want him to be faithful to me, so I want to at least try to make him faithful. So anyway, you know, I kind of learned early in life. I kind of straightened up the main place and fed him a nice dinner, lit the candles, had a little nice music on, had just fed his little tummy so it's full, so he's a little bit more inclined to be nice. And he's a nice man all the time. He's much more even than his wife. But anyway, so I said, honey, and I told him what my friend had said to me. And he said, that is the stupidest thing I've ever heard. He said, why would you let somebody else's law steal your joy? He said, you know, we're never even in the bedroom. We have all these asthmatic kids. Not that I don't wish we were, but we aren't, you know. He said, you know that when I walk in and, you know, you're happy and it's somewhat peaceful and we can just be together and be companions, that's what means a lot to me. You do a great job. Why would you let her law rest on your shoulders and take your joy away? So I want to ask you, who are you performing for? What of your friends have perfectly talented, brilliant, outstanding kids that when you put your children next to them, oh my gosh, why even try? Who has told you, well, if you don't use my curriculum, your children will not be perfect? What grandmother has said to you, when they wrote me the thank you note, do you know that they misspelled four words? You see, God does not want us to carry the bondage of the Pharisees. And he does not want you to teach your children to be future Pharisees of America. We are homeschoolers, we are Christians because God has called us to criticize everyone in the world. If you want your children to love God, you have to really teach them what God is like. God is compassionate, forgive 40 times 40 or 70 times 70 or whatever it is. You know, turn the other cheek. Give him your robe. Jesus said, I'm humble and meek. And ultimately, what I really want you to know from this talk is the only way for God for you to have joy and for you to endure is for you to submit to his fatherhood and say, Lord, I will do the thing I'm supposed to do now. Lord, I will accept this child. Lord, even if my wife or my husband never changes, I will become more godly. Even if blah, 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 whatever, you fill in the blank. The only way that you can endure, endure well. And I realized when I wrote this book, it's Dancing with My Father. I started a blog named Go Down Dancing. Because I wanted to go down, I wanted to meet Jesus face to face, living in the power of the Spirit, dancing like David did. And then Clay said, honey, I don't think you want to put a blog out there. Go down dancing. I don't think you're going to get the right visitors. So that's why I named it I Take Joy. But I realized I just like the metaphor dancing, you know? That's what David did. He danced before God with all of his heart. And let me tell you, I talked about this at my conference this year. Let me tell you about David dancing before God with all of his might. David was anointed to be king. Then it was 25 years until he became king of both kingdoms. And during those years, his life was attacked. Saul tried to kill him continuously. His wife ran away from him. He had people be unjust to him. He had children who were unjust. He had warriors who were unjust. And yet, David kept a faithful heart. Why did God love him? Not because he was perfect. Excuse me. Because David was faithful. He kept saying, I am serving the God of the universe. In his presence is fullness of joy. And so this whole picture of when he was dancing with God before all of his, with all of his might, it's not just David. You know all these Bible pictures where they just have this little tiny little underwear on. He's going, no. What David did was he said, if I'm going to be king of Israel, Saul was the people's choice. He was tall and perfect and wonderful, and everybody followed him because he was the good man. But David said, no, if I'm going to be king over both the houses of God's kingdom, then I want the Ark of the Covenant to be here because God is the only one who will help me be adequate to be king. Because if God's presence is here, then we will prosper. If we do not trust in God, we won't prosper. So David went to 30,000 of the families of Israel, and he said, I want you to celebrate with me. And he made them cakes and raisins, and he prepared a celebration for them. And he prepared hundreds of musicians, and he said, I want music to be played at every point. I want God to be worshipped. And he said, Levites, you need to get the choir, the musicians. This was like a presidential inauguration. He had music and bands and peoples and choirs. He had bulls and lambs that he was sacrificing. And why? Because he was saying, oh my God, I see that, I see that. Oh my God, I want that when I am king, it is because you are king in our midst. And so when David was dancing, he was dancing in the company of 30,000 people. They were all walking. They were all singing. La! They're probably singing the Alleluia chorus because they've been practicing. They were sacrificing bulls, and David was saying, God, you are my glory and my joy. I hope in you, not in anybody else, because they've let me down. Not because I'm great, but because you're the God. Do you know what he said when he went to Goliath? You go back there, he said, you come to me with a spear and a sword, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. What is your authority? The name of the Lord of hosts. You see, David came in the power of God. So when he became king, he said, I will be king in the power of God because when he's in our midst, he will bless us. And what I have to say is Michael or however you want to say her name, you know, when she's looking out the window being critical, and it said she looked on him with disdain. Okay, 30,000 of the Israelites were singing and marching and obeying and sacrificing and lifting their hands up to God. Why was she sitting at home? Why was she not? It said that she was barren the rest of her life. Do you know what I think? I think when we refuse to bow our knee and say, this is the day the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This problem, this child, this obstacle on my obstacle course, this is the day he's made. He's going to teach me something here. He's going to create a miracle here. He's going to bring his life here. I'm going to plant a flag and I'm going to rejoice. That's what David did. This is the day the Lord has made. You see, when Satan came to Adam and Eve, what did he do? He caused them to doubt in God's character. What would Satan love for you to do? He would love for you to give up on your ideals. He would love for you to think you're inadequate. Oh, they're better than me. Oh, they're smarter than me. Oh, they can figure it out better. No, you need to understand, you come to your children in the name of the Lord of hosts. You come to your marriage in the name of the Lord of hosts. I am so grateful that Clay and I have gotten this far. Because now we have this legacy of having been faithful to each other. I didn't even know how critical I was when I was first married to him. I don't know why he stayed married to me. I thought I was right. You know, if Clay would just do my will, I mean, I was a single missionary. I knew the Bible. If Clay would just be like me, then he could be a good person. But if he wasn't going, I mean, poor Clay. Why did he endure with me? Clay had issues. He didn't have a perfect background either. But we kept saying, okay, this is God's will. We will love each other. We will love our children. We will live with the asthmatics. We will live with the mentally ill children. We have some mentally ill children. We have obsessive compulsive off the chart, the most obsessive compulsive person that this doctor has ever tested. Do you know, do any of you have those? People will tell you they're demon possessed. No. When they take a picture of their brains, they're different. Obsessive compulsive types are the kind, this is how they are. When they're 2 years old, or when they're actually 13 months old, and you go to tie their shoe, and they lay on the floor, and they scream, and they have a fit, and they go, rah, 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 and you're thinking, what is the deal? I'm just tying your shoe. Well, then when they can be old enough to tell you what it was, they say, you know when you used to tie my shoes? You didn't tie the shoe strings exactly the same size. And all your friends will say, just spank them more. No, it's this mental thing. Okay, you know, we had issues. We had people who hated us. We had family who hated us. I look back now and I think, this is what God was doing. I said, okay, God, I will serve you. I will go to the ends of the earth because I'm a spiritual person. And then God said, I know you have a good heart, so I'm going to take you at your word. And then he goes like this. He says, you know, you're kind of depending on that thing. I'm going to take it away from you because then you'll really learn that you can trust me. And, you know, you kind of have a critical attitude. And you know what? If you have compassion on this child, you realize what a good father I am to have compassion on you. And you see, God discipline, he, children and family and difficulties are the way that he makes us holy. And do you know what holiness is? Holiness is saying, oh my goodness, the older I get, I don't know why you would love me, but I have you in my life. Thank you. You are wonderful. I don't know if I could have ever made it, but you've been so faithful to me, God. Holiness is having Christ at the place he's supposed to be, at the center of your life, in the heart of your life. I had my son Joel who came to me. He wrote me this great note. He came home and he left this note on my pillow. And he said, Mom, I am with mostly ungodly people. I'm surrounded by kids who are broken. I don't have very many people in my life who have ever even opened their Bible. And he said, I don't think I ever realized the heritage that you and Daddy have given me. But he said, do you know what I really appreciate the most? He said, the Clarksons know their flaws. They know their strengths. They know their weaknesses. But he said, I watched you and Daddy walk with God. I watched you pray when you had problems. I watched you go to the Word when we had issues. I watched you be gracious when we were teenagers. I watched you, in the messiness of life, hold on to the reality. And he said, that reality is what is taking me through my school in Boston. It's the reality I want to give to other people. Thank you for keeping going and making the right choices, because now I know how to live my life because I saw you all keep going. You see, your children will be forgiving of your imperfections. You are the people that they want to have as heroes. The rest of their life, they're going to be looking for your affirmation and love. You don't have to be perfect. You just have to have a heart for God. You are doing an amazing thing. You are changing the world one person at a time. You are bringing righteousness into the next generation because you're choosing to do this irrational thing called homeschooling. And I believe that if you understood how much God loved you, how willing he is to encourage you, that he has access to your children's brains and consciences, that he will strongly support those whose heart is completely his, that you would have a sense of how important what you're doing is, how great you are because you have learned to love God and you want to pass that love on to that generation. So let me pray for you. But endure, make the choice, stay courageous, last, because it'll be your story in heaven that you are the one who brought light into darkness, and your children will be able to say, and they were the ones who passed the baton on to me so that I could walk righteously. Let me pray. Lord, I thank you so much for these precious, precious parents. They have different hurts, different needs, different problems. I pray they'll give them to you now, that they'll trust you, that they'll say, I come in the name of the Lord of hosts. I'm not adequate, but you are. Give them grace with that child, that marriage, that non-marriage, that singleness, that whatever, Lord, you are the God who redeems. Cause them to love you more every day, to live more in your freedom and peace, and to see that you will say to them when they get to heaven as they walk by faith, well done, my good and faithful servant. I prepared you for good works to walk in, and you walked faithfully with me. You have pleased me by your heart. Bless them, keep them, cause your face to shine upon them, lift your countenance upon them, and give these precious, precious families peace. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.